This is a BiblioMotion audiobook, produced and distributed by Gildan Media in partnership with BiblioMotion. 101 Defenses, How the Mind Shields Itself, by Jerome S. Blackman, M.D., F.a.p.a. Narrated by Sean Pratt. We hope you enjoy this program. Preface. Steve, 26, wanted testosterone shots so he could function sexually with his wife. He had a good reason for the shots. He had undergone surgical removal of his pituitary gland several months earlier and now needed hormone replacement therapy. I was an intern at the time, on the internal medicine service in the hospital where Steve had been admitted for monitoring and adjustment of his replacement hormones. I didn't know much about psychology or defenses at the time, but one day on rounds, when I had a few moments alone with Steve, I mentioned my interest in his need for the testosterone shots. He explained that testosterone relieved his impotence with his wife. His embarrassment lessened as we talked, and I was able to complete the sexual history by inquiring if his sexual problems included lack of morning erections or inability to masturbate. At that point, Steve sighed. He looked over at the door to his room, making sure it was shut, and said, "Well, since we're talking about this honestly, there's something I should tell you. The truth is, I only need the shots to have sex with my wife. I have a girlfriend I don't need the shots for." Steve complained that his wife had never enjoyed sex. She had been a virgin at marriage. Since the birth of their 2-year-old son, sex had been relatively infrequent. He said his surgery didn't have much to do with the problem. Although he loved his wife, he could not think of a way of solving the problem, which, he said, she acknowledged was hers. He expressed a fervent desire to be able to enjoy sex with her. She had been a good wife in many other ways, helping him through his illness, for example. The following day, when I made rounds, Steve's wife was at his bedside. They apparently had discussed the situation. She expressed a wish to get over her serious sexual inhibition and asked whom she might consult for help. I obtained some referrals for her in the community from the internal medicine resident, who was my immediate supervisor. Years after completing my psychiatric and psychoanalytic training, I was able to formulate about what had occurred in my interactions with Steve. By asking about other areas of sexual difficulty, I had actually confronted Steve about various defenses he was using, including prevarication or lying about his impotence, displacement of his sexual wishes from his wife to his girlfriend, and rationalization and concretization, that is, finding an excuse by seeing his sexual problem as having a purely medical origin. In a supportive way, I also had expressed enough interest that Steve trusted me and turned to me with his maladaptive compromise formation, which was avoiding his wife and lying to her to avoid guilt, suppressing his frustration, and displacing his sexual wishes elsewhere. In other words, Steve knew that he was physically capable of sexual performance even without the testosterone shots, as evidenced by his activities with his mistress. However, he had convinced himself that he needed the shots in order to perform with his wife. They were like Dumbo's magic feather. Steve's favorable response to my confrontation of his defenses had led him to reveal his conflicts. Rather than take testosterone shots the rest of his life and depend on destructive extramarital contacts for sexual gratification, he and his wife now could face their psychological problems and resolve the conflicts that were interfering with their ability to enjoy sex within the marriage. 30 years later, Dr. C asked me, "Would you really say that? It's so aggressive." He was a U.S. Navy lieutenant finishing his psychology internship at the Naval Medical Center in Portsmouth, Virginia. I had just explained to his class that when they could see during evaluation that someone was lying about suicidal intentions in order to get out of the service, they could say to the person something like, "My impression is that you're not being truthful with me," and could add, "You're trying to manipulate me into going along with you." So you also are not treating me as your therapist. You're basically attempting to use me. After Dr. C's interjection about how aggressive these interventions sounded, I pointed out that lying and evaluation are defenses. If Dr. C confronted the defenses, as I suggested, perhaps a sailor would admit to using them, and then elaborate on the conflicts he had been avoiding. In other words, some of the interns' cases, who secretly carried the sardonic diagnosis of WU-10, an acronym for Want Out of the Navy, might actually be treatable with dynamic psychotherapy, and not just be a pain in the neck. In addition, confrontation of the defenses could help in diagnosis. The psychopathic or antisocial types would probably persist in lying, and the grandiose psychotic ones would probably verbally attack Dr. C for daring to question their motives. In any case, Dr. C could prevent himself from hating his work because he was being used. At least he would not just passively sit there, allowing the sailor to intimidate him. Dr. C liked my suggestion and reported thereafter that he enjoyed employing confrontation of defenses with some of his Wu-10s, occasionally finding a treatable one. He commented to me that he realized he had somehow equated being empathetic with being passive, so that he had felt some guilt about being direct in his approach to people he evaluated or treated. The human mind has an amazing capacity to invent mechanisms that shield a person from becoming aware of unpleasant emotions. These mechanisms often are disguised and operate outside of a person's awareness. Because of the stealthy quality of defenses, uncovering them and understanding their potentially detrimental effects can be useful. For example, a person who is unable to recognize anger toward a loved one may feel intense self-loathing instead. When that person shows up in the ER for severe depression, the ability to discuss the defensive operation of turning on the self can be extremely helpful in preventing a suicide attempt, or rather, self-destructive conduct. Understanding defenses is also valuable in other life situations. Recognizing a teenager's use of minimization and counterphobic behavior can be helpful to parents trying to steer their child away from dangerous activities. Understanding a rival's grandiosity may enable an executive to gain the upper hand in a competitive business situation. Confronting denial and rationalization is important for family members who are concerned with a loved one's alcoholism. Noticing identification with the lost object is helpful when comforting a grieving relative. Last but not least, the detection of distancing and avoidance mechanisms in a romantic relationship can clue you in that someone is not inclined toward the fidelity and constancy required for a long and happy marriage. In clinical situations, mentioning defenses to the wrong kind of person or at the wrong time can also be counterproductive. That's if you can even find the defenses, since they are so often unconscious. Intervening in a therapeutic way can be even more daunting. In this book, I have tried to provide a framework that explains the origination, properties, and causes of defensive activity, and have included a chapter on differential diagnosis that describes who should be treated with interpretive techniques and who should not. There is a section on how to decipher the pathological defenses being used. I have included separate chapters on how to zero in on defenses and then intervene supportively versus interpretively, depending on which techniques are indicated. And finally, I have included a chapter to demonstrate how to use confrontation of defenses as an adjunct to other techniques used in assessing suicidal propensities. Introduction. The term defense refers to the way the mind shuts feelings out of consciousness. It's common knowledge that therapists try to understand the feelings of people they treat. But in practice, understanding feelings usually isn't enough to help people overcome their problems. It's also necessary to explain how and why unconscious defenses are keeping people from knowing about their unpleasant feelings. In actuality, most emotional difficulties result from a combination of problematic defenses and effects. With adequate insight into their pathological defense mechanisms and feelings, people can more clearly understand the meanings and origins of their irrational behaviors, symptoms, and attitudes. That knowledge often relieves painful psychiatric symptoms such as depression and phobias, and enables people to make salutary changes in their lives. There are probably an infinite number of defenses, not only the 101 I've listed. Two of the greatest psychoanalytic theoreticians, Anna Freud and Charles Brenner, have emphasized that almost anything can be a defense. Looking away can be a defense. Screaming at someone can be a defense. Playing golf can be a defense. So can saving money, or at least all these activities may involve defenses. Whatever the mental activity or behavior, if it shields you from experiencing unpleasant emotion, it is defensive. Emotions can be pleasant or unpleasant. In general, it's the unpleasant ones that cause people the problems brought about by maladaptive defenses. More specifically, unpleasurable effects are defined as possessing two components: an unpleasurable sensation, plus a thought that something terrible is going to happen, which we call anxiety, or that something terrible has already happened, which we call the depressive effect. We can therefore expand the definition of defense as follows. Defenses are mental operations that, as a rule, remove some component or components of unpleasurable effects from conscious awareness, the thought, the sensation, or both. Diagnostically, we use these components of affects and defenses to explain, for example, the phenomenon of forgetting something that's important to remember, perhaps an appointment. The thought content gets shut out of consciousness. You may remember it an hour later when something jogs your memory. Then you realize you didn't really want to meet with the person anyway. In other words, the thought content, one part of the effect, was stored and could be retrieved from storage. But your mind switched off the thought to relieve you of the unpleasantness, the other part of the effect, of the memory. An analogy might be made to an electric circuit, where the potential for a current is present, a light bulb is intact, and the circuit has no damage. However, a switch has been thrown that breaks the circuit so that the light bulb does not work. The switch would be like a conscious defense. I'll put it out of my mind, or I don't want to go there. If the switch is thrown without your conscious intent, you have an unconscious defense. Unconscious defenses actually operate more like circuit breakers. When the current gets too great, the increase in amperage trips the circuit breaker, which breaks the circuit, and the light goes off. Analogously, when the intensity of effects, emotions such as anger, anxiety, depression, and guilt, threatens to melt down the functioning of the mind, a mental circuit breaker is thrown. Certain thoughts are switched out of consciousness, that is, forgotten. As with a circuit breaker, this type of forgetting occurs automatically. Diagnostically, we also have to consider that there may be primary defects in the bulb. Attempts to repair it lead to the construction of a delicately balanced bulb with faulty elements that at best blinks erratically, as in schizophrenia. The person's own attempts to repair the bulb or the wiring defects, like the defense of reconstruction of reality after a break in reality testing, may lead to short circuits, meaning delusions. In a different set of patients, those with borderline personality organization, it's as though the circuits are connected and the light bulb and power source are intact, but the wiring isn't strong enough to handle heavy amperage without melting the wires or tripping a circuit breaker. The weakness of the circuit may have been caused by the heat of chronically high amperage, much as some adult victims of child abuse had their circuits for effect management damaged by chronically inflamed rage and anxiety during long stretches of their upbringing. As a result, at times of power surges, the circuit with the wiring of a lower gauge will become overwhelmed and trip the circuit breaker. In adults with borderline personality, the analogy is that their limited effect tolerance can lead to a tendency to utilize defense. Finally, those people analysts refer to as neurotic have everything in the circuit intact, but The circuit breaker was placed there from a different circuit years ago and is no longer necessary. The wiring has since developed and is much stronger than it was in childhood, but that old circuit breaker may shut down the circuit even though there's no real present-day danger of overload. The therapist's job is to determine the kind of problem in the circuits. Then we either reconstruct the bulb, enhance the wiring, provide new circuit breakers, or, when neurosis is present, find the faulty unnecessary circuit breakers and allow placement of new switches more realistically commensurate with the needs of an adult. To complicate matters, some mental problems are not primarily due to defenses, but to a lack of functioning of other parts of the mind. For example, people's feelings can also overwhelm them, melting down their abilities to organize thoughts and to concentrate. Erosion of functions like concentration and organization of thought is not caused by defenses. But if people are late to a class they really hate and the professor ridicules them, it's likely they were avoiding class and perhaps even inviting punishment to defensively relieve their guilt. When you treat someone, it's a good idea to be familiar with common defenses so you can, first, find them. Next, you'll need to make decisions about whether to explain how problematic defenses are working, using dynamic therapy, or to suggest new defenses through supportive therapy. It's also a good idea to know what induces defensive activity. We will examine this in Chapter 1. Chapter 1. General Concepts About Defenses. Let's recap the definitions of defense and unpleasurable affect. Then we can go further in describing a host of properties and functions of defenses. Definitions of defenses and unpleasurable affects. Defenses are mental operations that remove components of unpleasurable affects from conscious awareness. Unpleasurable affects include anxiety, depression, and anger. Anxiety is composed of an unpleasurable sensation plus a thought that something terrible is going to happen. Depressive affect is an unpleasurable sensation plus a thought that something terrible has already happened. Anger involves an unpleasurable sensation plus a thought of destroying someone or something. The thought content for each of these affects may derive from perceptions of memories, from any developmental stage through the present, and may be reality-based, fantasy-based, or some admixture of the two. Triggers for defenses. Normal or average, expectable people. In normal people, a very intense affect may threaten to melt down or overwhelm the mental functions of thinking, organizing, and concentrating. Freud more technically called affects traumatic if they interfered with the ego functions of thinking, organizing, and concentrating. He writes, "Ms. A.B., a 39-year-old woman, was in treatment with me for marital problems. She reported discovering that her husband was hiding marijuana in the medicine cabinet in the master bath. She suppressed her anger until her 13 and 15-year-old children were sleeping, and then expressed her multiple concerns to her husband. Worries about his health, the kids' well-being, his arrest or prosecution, the danger of him committing foolish acts while stoned, and the risk of public humiliation. She also objected to his setting an immoral and illegal example for the children. When he defended his right to smoke pot, she lost it. She began crying, but stopped herself. The next day at noon, while she was at a garden store picking out flowers for the front yard, Mr. A.B. called her on her cell phone. He was at home, waiting. They were supposed to have met for a hot sex date while the kids were at school. She had completely forgotten and felt guilty that she had disappointed him. In this situation, Ms. A.B. at first suppressed her anger consciously, but when her husband was unreasonable in his reaction to her concerns, her anger and depression became traumatic due to their intensity. She then instituted several other defenses without being aware that she was doing so. She repressed the hot sex date. This both relieved her of her anger and simultaneously expressed it, a compromise formation. She used projective identification, creating severe frustration in her husband to relieve her own frustration about him not being more attentive to her wishes. She identified with the aggressor by doing to him what he had done to her, that is, ignored her wishes. She rejected his sexual overture and displaced her attention onto feminine elements, flowers for her garden, symbolically reaffirming her femininity. She thereby repressed the insult she felt because he had disregarded her concern. She also isolated or shut off the sensations of her depression regarding the marriage. When I pointed out to her that forgetting the date with her husband and focusing on the flowers apparently had these meanings, she became more aware of her anger at him and her guilt. Her conflict between anger and guilt had also caused her to become passive when he argued with her. In her follow-up session a few days later, she reported that she had explained to her husband that she felt angry and discouraged about the marriage because of his stubborn insistence on committing illegal, self-destructive drug abuse. Her confrontation led him to rethink his obstinacy, especially in light of the potential impact on their teenage children. He apologized and threw out the marijuana. Psychosis and borderline personality. In people with psychosis or borderline personality, on the other hand, even mild affects may melt down ego functions. In those illnesses, affect tolerance and ego strength is minimal to begin with. Mr. D.B., age 25, had been severely neglected by his mother throughout his childhood. She allowed his older brothers to beat him up. In addition, he witnessed his adolescent sister's prostitution when he was in junior high school. Since age 15, he had been a binge drinker. All of these factors, that is, the overwhelming rage at his brothers, the sexual overstimulation caused by seeing his sister's sexual activities, and the interference with the development of ego strength by his use of alcohol as an affect neutralizer throughout adolescence, had led Mr. DB to develop a serious weakness in affect tolerance. Now in graduate school, when asked to do an extra assignment, he felt enraged to the point where he was not able to concentrate and organize or integrate his thoughts. He couldn't study. To handle his overwhelming anger and depressive affect, he defensively blamed his girlfriend, projective blaming, for having encouraged him to go to graduate school. He also became grandiose, that is, he thought that he would report the professor for unfairness, and he drank. This is substance abuse as a defense. In other words, due to ego damage in affect tolerance, a normative stress like an extra homework assignment, causing anger, led him to become overwhelmed by rage. Pathological defenses were then brought into play to assuage his shame over experiencing breakdown in his ego functions of concentration and integration. Neurotic illness. In people with neurotic illnesses, including phobias, conversions, panic, obsessions, compulsions, some impulsivity, some depressions, ego strength may be adequate. But even if an affect's intensity is only mild, a small amount of the affect acts as a signal. This signal affect triggers defenses in situations that remind the person, usually unconsciously, of prior situations when they actually had been overwhelmed. Renee, age 34, felt panicky. Her thoughts about her anxiety ran to her recent wish to bear children. She was afraid to tell her husband, since they initially had agreed not to conceive. In addition, Renee didn't want to become dependent on her husband's income. She noted how, as a teenager, she had had to beg her father for her allowance and how she hated it. I pointed out that she seemed to expect her husband to be as parsimonious as her father had been. Renee realized that this was an unfair characterization of her husband, who had always been generous with her. Following a course of brief psychotherapy for a few months, Renee broached the subject of children with her husband, who, it turned out, was excited and happy about the idea. Renee had been using the defenses of reticence, avoidance, and pseudo-independence to shield herself from transference-based anxiety with her husband. In other words, her signal anxiety, not overwhelming in nature, had generated the pathological defenses. Conscious versus unconscious defenses. Shutting off affects is like breathing. People usually are not aware of the regulation, the unconscious defense, but they may purposely take control of the regulation through conscious defense. In fact, defenses operate consciously and unconsciously. People can use them on purpose or without being aware of it. In analytic nomenclature, the distinction between conscious and unconscious employment of a defense is sometimes made by using a different term. Suppression, for example, indicates purposeful forgetting, whereas repression means unconscious forgetting. Similarly, prevarication means purposeful lying, whereas confabulation suggests falsification that occurs without the person's awareness. Note that Ms. A.B. had initially suppressed anger. Later, she repressed angry thoughts of leaving her husband. Basic versus ancillary defenses. In adults, the primary defense mechanisms are usually repression and isolation of affect. According to C. Brenner, all affects have two components, sensations and thoughts. The sensations may be pleasurable or unpleasurable, and the thoughts, conscious or unconscious. Repression is the term given to the phenomenon where a person's mind automatically shuts the thought content of an affect out of consciousness. Isolation refers to the mind shutting the sensation out of awareness, but not necessarily the thoughts. Other defensive operations, in general, are helper defenses that support repression, isolation, or both. Kernberg has taken exception to this general rule, theorizing that some people, whom he diagnoses with borderline personality, use splitting as a primary defense. Adaptiveness versus maladaptiveness. Most defenses can be used adaptively or maladaptively. In fact, a therapist should probably only mention a defense to a person in treatment if the defense seems maladaptive. Maladaptive defense constellations are responsible for obsessions, phobias, and disturbed coping with external situations. The therapist, upon deciphering the culpable defenses, will usually consider bringing them to the attention of the person in treatment, a technique analysts call confrontation, which we'll cover in Chapter 5. An accountant experienced no trouble at work due to her perfectionism, intellectualization, and insistence on ritualistic management of details. However, her husband's frustration with her perfectionism was disrupting their marriage. The therapist, therefore, brought those obsessional defenses to her attention and suggested that she was thereby protecting herself from some unpleasant feelings. Emergency versus chronic defenses. Defenses are commonly used in emergency situations. The person experiences a threat of overwhelming affect, whether that threat is real or not, and then tries to derail the affect. Some people, however, experience defensive operations chronically, always blaming others or constantly talking too much. Emergency defenses developed in parents when their son accidentally got his finger cut off in a storm door. His parents experienced severe anxiety, guilt, and depressive affect. Their emergency defenses prevented those intense affects from interfering with their judgment, anticipation, reality testing, and psychomotor activity. The father isolated unpleasant sensations while planning a course of action. The mother considered the prognosis, that is, intellectualized. They both suppressed fear. The father calmly drove the child to the emergency room with the mother calmly, or counterphobic, holding the severed finger on ice. They couldn't indulge their feelings of panic or terror until their son was safely delivered to the care of the ER doctor. Their defenses protected their autonomous ego functions so that a decision, or judgment or anticipation, regarding the hospital, which was reality testing, could be made expeditiously and the child could be protected while being transported, psychomotor. The finger was saved. Preconscious automatisms are groups of defenses that chronically arise in symbolic situations. Mr. J., an electrical engineer, consulted me as he was about to lose his job. He complained that his colleagues were lazy and flaunted rules. He felt he had to report even minor transgressions against unimportant regulations. I soon understood that he did this in a vociferous, obnoxious way. When I pointed out that his style of complaining provoked others to dislike him, and that he spoke obnoxiously, He recalled witnessing his mother tolerate verbal abuse from his father, which he considered a transgression. She had told Mr. J that she wished she could have confronted his father. Mr. J had identified with the victim, leading him to behave in a way his mother had wished for herself, to actively confront wrongdoing. At the same time, he disidentified from her passivity, becoming active, that is, turning passive into active, and he developed a transference to the company, unconsciously seen as an abusive father, which prevented him from remembering the rage and fear he had felt toward his father. In addition, he defended against his anger at his father by using identification with the aggressor. Now, Mr. J verbally abused people. Moreover, he displaced his anger toward his father onto others. His chronic preconscious automatism of obnoxious confrontation, which operated when he saw a rule being bent, included his defensive operations of provocation, impulsivity, disidentification, identifications with the victim and the aggressor, transference, displacement, and turning passive to active. After a series of confrontations and interpretations of his defenses and affects, he better understood his misbehavior and could desist from it, and was ultimately able to obtain and retain a new job. Defense mechanisms versus defensive operations. Anna Freud defines a defense mechanism, such as projection, as a mental tool used against an affect, akin to using a hammer to hit a nail. Defensive operation is a broader term that includes any other mechanism so employed, such as using a shoe to hit a nail. Masturbation, for example, a sexual pleasure-related activity, may be used defensively to relieve depression or anxiety. Even more complex behavior may be used defensively. For example, after Theodore Roosevelt's wife and mother died on the same day in 1884, he left New York City to live as a cowboy in the Badlands of the Dakotas for over 2 years. This sudden change in behavior seems to have been, at least in part, his conscious attempt to relieve, that is, defend against, severe grief. In another example, antidepressant medication was requested by a philanderer, in spite of the fact that he knew it interfered with his sexual performance. After he badgered his female therapist to prescribe it, she came to realize and interpret to him that he wished to have her punish him to relieve his guilt over infidelity. In other words, his wish for and use of medication was defensive. Simple defense versus character defense. Some defense mechanisms are simple and stand alone, such as intellectualization. For example, at a party, a person talks about a recently read book to relieve social anxiety. Character defenses are more pervasive, chronic, and complex. They often involve other aspects of mental functioning. An example would be condescension, which includes projection, self-aggrandizement, devaluation, identification, and splitting. A more subtle character defense is the assumption of the role of discipline. Many people will attempt to treat their therapists as omniscient gurus as a way of avoiding painful affects. Conflict resolving versus developmental properties of defenses. Most defenses are used to manage affect generated by intra-psychic conflict, but some seem to be building blocks of normal psychic structure and are not used just to ward off affects. Introjection of parents' soothing ministrations early in life, besides calming and defending against the infant's emotional storms, also seems necessary for the child to develop the ego strength of affect tolerance. Identification with parents' value systems during latency, ages 6 to 10 years, doesn't only protect the child from fear of parental punishment. It also helps establish an important structure, the superego. In fact, values, ideals, and critical capacities, meaning the superego, are highly influenced by identifications throughout life. In childhood and adolescence, identifications with idealized teachers, coaches, and media figures have a powerful effect. In adulthood, identification with the values of mentors, employers, and organizations can affect people's values. John Dean, in his autobiography of his role in the Watergate scandal, details the deterioration of his value system as an adult via his idealizations of and identifications with Nixon, Haldeman, and Ehrlichman. Defense versus defense. Defenses, in addition, may shut out of consciousness any mental content or function, including sexual and hostile wishes, conscience pangs, and reality perceptions. Sometimes, a defense may even prevent another defense from becoming conscious, as in a man who minimized his chronic joking, which in turn had prevented him from becoming aware of sad feelings. Greenson has pointed out that although some people experience resistance to treatment, they won't admit it. He called this resistance to resistance, usually caused by defense. He wrote, "A 35-year-old man was 20 minutes late for his first appointment and apologized, saying he'd forgotten about it until the last minute. When I tried to interpret that his forgetting might indicate that he had some second thoughts about even consulting me, he insisted that it was a meaningless mistake. Later in the consultation session, after he had recalled his criticism of and frustration with prior therapists, I was able to successfully point out that he had preferred to think his forgetting his appointment with me was meaningless, so that he would not have to face his fear that I would be as disappointing as his previous therapists had been." Flying in formation. Defenses usually occur in groups or constellations. Typical defense constellations occur in the following pathological states. 1. Criminal psychopathy, for criminals and other antisocials. Prevarication, protective blaming, and rationalization. For example, "I didn't kill her. I didn't even know her. The district attorney said if I admitted to it, I would serve time and not get the chair. That's the only reason why I confessed. Also, I was so upset about being arrested, I didn't know what to say." 2. Borderline personality organization. Its defenses: denial, projective identification, idealization, de-differentiation, devaluation, grandiosity, and splitting. For example, "My husband's an idiot. Not like Steve. He's wonderful. He understands my need to have two men in my life. Steve tells me what to do, and I do it because I agree with him. My husband can kiss my ass. I'm staying with Steve this weekend, and my husband can take care of the children. Why shouldn't I be in control for a change? Why do I want to die?" 3. Hysteria. A. Histrionic subtype. Its defenses: repression, one affect versus another, socialization, dramatization, transference, inhibition of ego function, and garrulousness. A new consultee opens her first appointment saying, "It's so wonderful to meet you, Dr. C. I know your husband's an accountant with Anderson. It must have been so hard to go through the scandal. Well, what about my problem? It's so embarrassing. Do we really need to talk about it? I'm sure you've heard worse. You seem so stable and so worldly." B. Conversion subtype. Defenses: repression, symbolization, and somatization. For example, after a heated argument with his wife, a man loses strength in his arms. And C. Phobic subtype, 3A or 3B, plus projection, displacement, symbolization, and avoidance. 4. Obsessional disorders. Defenses: projection, displacement, symbolization, concretization, isolation of affect, reaction formation, undoing in rituals, perfectionism, hyperpunctuality, parsimoniousness, intellectualization, rationalization, hypercriticism of the self or others, and inhibition of critical judgment. 5. Depressions. Defenses: turning on the self of rage and or criticism, reaction formation, oral libidinal regression, inhibition of ego functions, such as psychomotor and speech, provocation of punishment, identification with the victim, and identification with the lost object. Appearance during development. Many defense mechanisms initially appear during a specific phase of childhood development. In adults, most defenses can be used together, regardless of when they originated. In other words, an adult may use garrulousness and intellectualization, which began in latency, sexual intercourse, the adult genital, identification with the ideal object, in adolescence, and projective blaming, anal, together as follows. A depressed man sweet talks, garrulousness, a woman into bed, sexual intercourse as a defense, the way his cooler older brother used to do, identification with the idealized object, and thereby feels less depressed. Later, when the woman wants to stay overnight and have breakfast together, he accuses her of being pathologically dependent, projective blaming, and projection. Compromise formation, or the principle of multiple function. Although a defensive operation prevents some aspect of mental functioning, usually an affect, from becoming conscious, the defense itself may take on other meanings and serve other functions as well. For example, if you identify with someone you admire, an idealized object, you relieve guilt over competitive hostility and at the same time gratify a wish to be like that person. Therefore, theoretically speaking, besides the defense being part of a compromise formation, a complex mental formation that simultaneously expresses and defends against affects, the defense itself is a compromise formation. Keeping this principle in mind helps in treating people. For instance, you interpret to a woman that her silence is an identification with her mother that helps her avoid anger at her mother. She responds, "Is my not talking bothering you too?" Here, her identification of silence not only avoids her hostility, it simultaneously is designed to provoke you, which expresses her hostility. Summary. Defenses are mental operations that usually prevent various ideas, urges, emotions, and even other defenses from reaching consciousness. At times, certain defenses, such as identification, can also be employed for the development of psychic structure. Defenses are triggered by normative affects when people have limitations in ego strength, as well as by signal affects and traumatic affects. Defenses can be used consciously or unconsciously, and may be adaptive to the environment or highly maladaptive. They are typically used in emergencies, but may also be chronic, as in neurotic, meaning anxiety or depressive, symptoms. When they fly in formation, constellations of defenses explain the causation of many psychiatric disturbances, as per the principle of multiple function, meaning the defenses are part of the solution to intra-psychic conflicts. At the same time, defenses are themselves compromise formations. Keeping in mind these general concepts regarding defensive operations, we can now move on to the definitions of 101 common defenses in chapters 2 and 3. Following that, we'll address how defense theory is used in diagnosis, in assessment of treatability, in supportive and dynamic technique, and in determination of suicide risk. Quick definitions of 101 defenses in approximate order of their first appearance during development. The oral phase, 0 to 3 years. 1. Projection. You attribute your own stuff to another person. 2. Introjection. You form an image of another person. 3. Hallucination. You see or hear what you are trying not to think about, such as wishes, comments, fantasies, or criticisms, with no reality testing. Anal phase, 1.5 to 5 years. 4. Projective identification. Three common ways this term is used: A. Projecting so much of yourself onto someone else that you massively distort him or her. B. Stimulating in someone else your unpleasant affects. Misery loves company. And C. Stimulating in someone else your unpleasant affects plus acting like the person who had made you feel so bad. 5. Projective blaming. You unfairly blame someone else for your problem. 6. Denial. Assumes you've perceived reality. Reality sense is functional. A. Denial per se. A disavowal of a reality in spite of overwhelming evidence of its existence. B. Denial indeed. Behavior that symbolically says that nasty reality isn't true. C. Denial in fantasy. Maintaining erroneous beliefs so you won't have to see the reality. And D. Denial by words. Using special words to convince yourself of the falsity of a reality. 7. De-differentiation, self-object fusion. You become whatever someone else wants you to be. 8. Splitting. You see certain people as purely holistic and others as purely loving, or you now hate the devil you loved. 9. Animism. You give human qualities to non-human entities. 10. De-animation. The person you see isn't human, so you don't have to worry. 11. Reaction formation. You feel opposite, for example, so nice you can't tell you're angry. 12. Undoing and rituals. You go against your conscience, your superego, or you do what you feel guilty about and atone by punishing yourself in another symbolic act. 13. Isolation of affect. You are unaware of the sensation of affects. 14. Externalization. You think society will criticize you, but actually you feel guilty. 15. Turning on the self. You're angry at someone, but attack or kill yourself instead. 16. Negativism. You refuse to cooperate and treat other people condescendingly. 17. Compartmentalization. You inhibit yourself from making connections. 18. Hostile aggression. You get into fights to hide unpleasant feelings. First genital phase, 2 to 6 years. 19. Displacement. You feel one way toward a person, but shift it to another person or situation. 20. Symbolization. You give irrational meaning to some aspect of mental functioning. 21. Condensation. You weld together disparate ideas that are contiguous. 22. Illusion formation or daydreaming. You consciously visualize a scene that is upsetting or pleasant and know it's a fantasy. 23. Prevarication. You lie on purpose, for a reason. 24. Confabulation. You lie without knowing it to relieve lowered self-esteem. 25. Repression. You forget thoughts without wanting to. 26. Negative hallucination. You don't see something upsetting that's right in front of you. 27. Libidinal regression or psychosexual regression. You are afraid of sex and assertiveness, so you become dependent, oral, or stubborn, anal, instead. 28. Ego regression. There are three ways this term is used. A. Interference with the function. Your ego function or ego strength stops working, so you can't feel something unpleasant. B. Reversion to earlier defense mechanisms. You start using defense mechanisms that arose in an early age of development. And C. Inefficient defense operations. Your defenses fail to shut off affect, and the failure relieves guilt by punishing you. 29. Temporal regression. You focus on earlier times to not think about a current conflict. 30. Topographic regression. You dream to avoid painful reality. 31. Suppression. You purposely try to forget. 32. Identification with a fantasy. You act like your favorite hero or heroine. 33. Identification with parents' unconscious or conscious wishes and fantasies. You do as your parents forbid, act out their corrupt wishes, and get punished. 34. Identification with the ideal image or object. You think and act like someone you think is great. 35. Identification with the aggressor. You act abusive to a person because someone has acted abusive to you. This protects you from feeling angry. 36. Identification with the victim. You act like someone else by either allowing or seeking victimization. You do this as a rescue wish or to fight off your own anger or guilt. 37. Identification with the lost object. You act like a lost loved one. You keep souvenirs and never grieve. You've got established pathological mourning. 38. Identification with the introject. You make an introject part of your superego. 39. Seduction of the aggressor. You seduce someone sexually or sycophantically to relieve fear. Latency phase, 6 to 11 years. 40. Sublimation. You engage in an activity that symbolically represents a fantasy. 41. Provocation. You get other people to have sex with or punish you or both. 42. Rationalization. You make excuses to relieve tension, usually after denying some reality. 43. Rumination. You overanalyze and spin your wheels trying to solve problems. 44. Counterphobic behavior. You do exactly what scares you. 45. Intellectualization. You get cranked up about a peculiar theory of behavior. 46. Socialization and distancing. You use your social ability to distract yourself from painful thoughts. 47. Instinctualization of an ego function.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.